not so good is once you're on the journey and you're trying to kind of plot whether you're late or whether you're early, and if you're going to meet and if you're going to get there on time. But I would say the Arima app is actually pretty good at that, because you can kind of track your own bus, the bus that you're on in relation to the timetable. Now, the point that you make actually is a really good one, that the feeds to those different apps all need to be the same and accurate and the same source of information. So it's no good if different apps are presenting the wrong information in different ways. It all needs to be the right information. So we've been doing quite a lot of work in the background on the accuracy in particular of our real-time information feed, because quite frankly, it's not good enough at the moment. Only around 85% of journeys are being properly and accurately tracked. And while that's great if you're on one of those 85% of journeys, if you're on one of the 50, that's not so good. And if you can't rely on the information that's being provided to you, if you've got any hesitation at all that that might not be right information, then you're actually not going to rely on that app to give you the right information. So you've identified two really important points. I'm happy to pick the specific ticketing one, because I actually don't think that should be happening, so I'll hopefully make that work with you. But be assured that we're dealing with the issue around accuracy of information, in particular the back office, because it's that feeds the apps that present the information to
you. Okay, I see Councillor Dean.
Thank you, Chair. Just to pick up from 2 points raised by my colleague Councillor Lewis. As someone who uses public transport a long time, by choice, one of the big bugbears I've got, it was the case when I was on Merseyside until 4 or 5 years ago, is real-time information. Most cities around the world, and some in the UK, you can go to a bus stop and it will tell you when the bus is due. The information is fairly accurate because it will tell you when the bus has been delayed for traffic or whatever. I understand Merseyside is in the process of removing real-time information from bus shelters, because they don't see it as a value anymore. And I'd be interested in your view on that, because, as I say, as someone who uses it, if you didn't, the example Councillor Lewis gave, where you don't have access to a smartphone, you don't have access to that, the information the bus shelter will tell you your bus is due in 15 minutes or it's not, it's been delayed, you can make an alternative choice. If that information is not at the bus shelter, you're standing there for 15, 20, 30 minutes for a bus that's not going to come. So, what's the update on real-time information bus shelters?
Just want to be clear that we're not looking to remove real-time information from shelters. So there's around, I think, 150 shelters across the city of Egypt out of 6,000 bus stops that have real-time information. So the coverage actually is pretty limited. We could take the choice that we're going to really expand that and do something that gives real significant coverage. But at the moment, we can't identify how on earth we would fund that. If I'm quite honest, it's extremely expensive rolling out what we're doing, what we've done previously, and screens cost a lot of money, the maintenance of those screens cost a lot of money, but actually the connections of electricity and power to bus shelters can cost £20,000 for to connect one bus shelter. So I think a significant rollout of what we've been doing previously isn't necessarily the right thing to do, but we are looking at other options. Since we rolled out real-time information, the proliferation of smartphones is massive. So we appreciate some people don't have them, but actually the significant majority of people do. And you can actually personalise travel information in that way much better. And we've also got digital advertising screens, and we're talking to our suppliers about how we use those to present real-time information. So that's kind of where we are with that.
Okay, Councillor Thomas.
It's just a question. Are there any incentives to improve transport apps and accessibility for people with disabilities and mental health conditions?
That's not specific thing that we're working on at the moment. I think we recognise the importance of that. As I touched on, the open data provisions within the Bus Services Act, we're expecting a proliferation of different apps which will help different people and be much more specific, I think, than what we've got now. And actually better the open market developing those sorts of things than us trying to kind of second guess everyone's needs. So I think that's certainly an area area that will improve. I'm taking the board your comments and I'll take that back into our next slides so we can look at how we can maybe address that.
Okay, I'm conscious that the Mayor's joined us, but I do think that Councillor Murphy indicated, so for one final question, unless anybody else has got any others, I'll call Councillor Murphy.
Certainly it's published, but I've produced a bespoke presentation for this area, so I'm happy to distribute that for you.
If you could send us the link, that would be useful, then we could have a look into that.
Yeah.
Do we have any other questions from the committee on this? No, I just have one final one, which I think the committee would agree with. There was reference made to contactless payment moving forward. I would have a concern for some of the transport users, particularly the elderly, who may not have those bank cards, but also the young people. You know, you're making an assumption that people who are 13, 14 have a bank account. So I would argue that, you know, attention should still be paid to those people who perhaps don't have a contactless method of payment.
Just want to be clear on that. So we're not looking to replace cash with contactless. Clearly, the more transactions that are done by a contactless technology, the quicker boarding can be and the faster journeys can be. That we recognise that there's still a good number of people that, for a variety of reasons, would want to pay cash or would prefer to pay cash. It's really important that those people can still do that and that they're able to use more services. For all the people, the Walrus Card kind of provides that.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Matt. We have agenda item 8, which is work plan. Before that, we have the new LCR Mayor, who I've not actually met.
I've got a film.
So I understand he's been requested to give a presentation of his 100-day plan, which was circulated, a draft was circulated earlier this week.
Congratulate them or commiserate them for being part of the panel committee, because I know that it's fundamental to the success of what it is that we need to do as a mayor of the municipal authority. And I said during the election that it didn't fear scrutiny. I actually welcomed it. So I'm glad that you have such a prominent role in what it is that we need to do to ensure the success of what I'm certain that everybody in the city region wants, which is to move our combined ourselves yearly forward and to capitalise on the huge opportunities that we have through devolution. I'm going to highlight the work programme. So on the first slide, for instance, I don't expect everybody to be able to read a table on the right-hand side. It'll make hopefully a little clearer a little bit later on. But the 100-day plan is about building on the good work that's happened so far. So we have started from a blank sheet of paper. The two previous chairs of the Combined Authority put in place lots of good things. We're building on what both Councillor Phil Davis and Mayor Joe Anderson previously have done. But we're very ambitious for the city region, and we think that we need to be more vocal in communicating the good things that we've done to date and what we plan to do. So the structure is around five pillars, which you'll see are ambitious, fair, green, connected, and together. And what we've done on the right-hand side, I'll extrapolate some of that. It's in four time slices. Each one is 25 days. So we can at least then try to track our progress as we go along to delivering the overall strategy. I'll just go through the devolution job objectives. We need to seize the opportunities of devolution and be prepared for the next wave of devolution. We know that something's coming. We don't actually know what the negotiations are going to be about yet. The government hasn't yet given us any outline of that. We do know early next year that there'll be a further wave of devolution talks, and we want to ensure that decisions that we take and make are on behalf of the people that we represent. The key projects which you'll see on these are the tangible outputs that will change the lives of those people who are either living or working or studying in the city region. There are a number of my manifesto commitments that we've built in, mostly around the fairness and social justice agenda. There are events that showcase the local city region assets and talents. So we're going to promote and start international brands. That's not new, but we need to do that. Use those to attract further events and celebrate the talent that we have. And there are a number of sort of key business as usual activities in the city region that we'll use for the Mayoral Combined Authority to highlight and showcase the improvements and the progress that we're making. So whilst this bit is all about the short-term delivery plan to set the strategic direction, it's worth noting that there's already significant progress on a number of the areas of delivery within the programme. And we're making very, very good progress on our devolution commitments. We're also moving ahead to the best use of the single investment fund to drive economic growth. There are lots of projects in all of your areas bidding for it. On the SIF funding, we're confident that we're on track to deliver what it is that we said to the government will deliver, and that will have the effect of moving the economic fortunes forward for us all. Of course, there's still lots more to do, so we need, for instance, more engagement. I'm acutely aware of that. We've been spending the first sort of, what have we got now, 9 weeks trying to sort out capacity issues, but we need to know that we need to do more about engaging with the wider community. We need to ensure absolutely that the Mayoral Combined Authority and the local city region is seizing the opportunities and the big opportunities that come up within governments or funding streams, for instance, or initiatives that we need to bid into. We will be setting out our strategic vision. So as well as this 100-day delivery plan, we want a 3-year, 5-year and a 10-year plan for the city region that everybody will buy into, and that lot of consultation, that everybody will be part of that. And we'll be taking forward a programme of transformation, so there are some really juicy bits within this. So since my election and the hiatus that we've had because of the general election, there's already been significant activity. So that the highlights include the opening of the Alston technology building, which is 11 pendulum old cars long in Halton, which not only is hopefully going to continue for several years in refurbishing those that rolling stock, but also has the opportunity to be transformed for manufacturing at a future date. And that's something that I'm very keen on doing. I think it'd be great if the area that started the rail revolution went back to being the epicentre for some of the delivery of the new rolling stock that we'll need. The very positive meeting that we had with Kent Skates, who's the Minister for North Wales. Whilst we've got 1.5 million people in our area, our functional economic geography is much bigger than that. In North Wales is very much part of our thinking. We had a great session with Lord Jim O'Neill, and he's already carried out a rough and ready strategic economic review on some of the documentation that we've already had, we've got in existence. So the State of the City region report that my department did on behalf of the Heston Town Institute, and our strategic growth plan, which is the LEP document. He's had a look at what we're doing, whether we're doing it right, and whether there are more end gaps in that, and he's come back and reported. The Combined Authority Oxford backed Liverpool's 2022 bid, and I think everybody here will hope and offer Liverpool its very best wishes and luck for the announcement. So on all those, I'm delighted to say you see that very green, those have been delivered much more than that. On the next time slice, which is already underway, a key priority during my middle term is that we invest in people, and people, I think, hopefully be aware of my background in schools. And it has to be a priority that we give people the opportunities to get the right skills. So we'll be launching our skills commission and developing our skills strategy, and that's going to be announced, as we see, in the next period. We also need to invest in our infrastructure, and so another priority for me, for instance, is taking forward the Mersey Tiling project. Now, people think that in some way I was announcing this as if it was new. 1982 is the document that I found, which was the first announcement of it. So it's nobody's idea, it's been around for a long time. The thing is, it's in the devolution deal, and the government has said there is a real opportunity for us to look at this and help us through it. So we've already started with a special purpose vehicle where we can get the intellectual property title so that it becomes ours. It's owned by us, it's owned by the Combined Authority and everybody in the city region. And then we can start to move the thing forward. It's not about another feasibility study. We know that it can work. It's about delivery now. We're hoping to announce a private sector lead for this who has a track record of delivery of renewable projects. I think I've probably said too much, but that's going to be happening very shortly. We need to use our other natural assets as well to benefit us all, as well as linking into renewable energy, we also need to stitch up and join up our digital infrastructure. And again, within this period, we're hoping to say much more, but we need the government's help in a lot of this. Whilst we get, as we know, £30 million per year for 30 years, it's a total of £900 million. We've had an equivalent of £1.5 billion taken from local authorities during the austerity years. So it's not even going to replace the money that has already gone. We need to use it much more innovatively. We need to get a return. We need to have a steady revenue on the monies that we invest. So hopefully that will be one of the things the government will help us with. And transport, of course, remains one of the most hold the stance of economic growth. This includes the Hope Care project, with which investment from the combined authority, as he said, was opened last week, before. So, again, pleased to say that all of those were on track for delivery if you get the point. On the time slice 3, during this period, we're going to take forward with business a lot of this, to include the launch of the Liverpool City Music Insight Programme, which is a series of business conferences, briefings, workshops, seminars, roundtables, etc. And that's going to help drive the growth of the city music economy. We're going to be scoping how to best deliver the Liverpool City Music Innovation Awards. We want to make this a regular feature. We really want to create an ecosystem around which businesses, especially young startup businesses, really aim for the opportunities that the fourth industrial revolution might offer us. We want to ensure that we're connected through an integrated transport service that's affordable and sustainable, including the rollout of the next fleet of low emission buses, and building on our international standing. One of the arguments around what we should be called, and if you remember, Pickle wanted to call us the Halt and Nosey, Liverpool, Sevens, Tellens, we're all combined authority. One of the benefits of being the Liverpool combined authority, Liverpool City Region, is that it's known internationally, and we need to really build on that international standing, especially in the context of Brexit. And we're hoping to appoint ambassadors who can help the City Region internationally as well. This together with the opportunities that the 2018 International Festival of Business for Business will provide us as a great mechanism for generating business connections, increasing business transaction, and of course exports. And then the final time slice. If anybody's doing the calculation, you'll see that it's not 100 days from the election, it's 100 days from the general election, because we were impaired there, so there was nothing that we could do, so we were all stymied from actually trying to do a lot of the stuff that we wanted to do early doors and concentrate on the stuff. It's from the day after the general election. But one of the main commitments is to ensure that across the city region, we're listening and engaging to together experts and practitioners to respond to all the challenges that we do face. You'll also see that there's up on that slide fairness and social justice advisory board. This is something that I've been absolutely determined to see come about in our city region. It will be the first in the country. We won't have any statutory responsibility, but it will be a very important role for those people who will be advisors to what it is that we need to do. We want to put fairness at the heart of what combined authority is all about. There's a bit of question time again. This is additional scrutiny, if you like. It's not part of the constitution, it doesn't really. It's another way that we can engage with people out in the six districts. Now we're going out to the six districts and facing the public question time there. We start with St Helens, but we'll have one such review in other areas. And September and October, which is a really exciting time, when we showcase to the world some of our leading assets in the London City region, to be known as the place for doing business and innovation space. I want it to be a laboratory for innovation, if you like, so that people feel that if they've got ideas, that we're the place that they can come and we can help them out. So, although it's also not shown on this plan, there's an obligation on the combined authority, especially with your roles, to set a revised budget in this period. So we'll happily include that in the corporate plan. But I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much. Do we have any questions, please? Councillor Sullivan?
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Steve. Thanks for a great presentation there. Two questions. I'm concerned about your capacity. I mean, you've got a great programme there, and the first 20 pages to be commended, and the stuff you've got on there. So, my question is about capacity. The other one is, I'm a Wirral councillor. Part of your manifesto was on tunnel charges, and it is very contentious, as you know, over on the other side of the border. Particularly in view of the government has now just announced that the scrapping the toll charges on both seven bridges. You've got the Halton Bridge, which will be open fairly soon, that we're going to charge. So there's no way of getting across the Mersey without paying. And I'd like your comments on that, Steve. And I saw it was on the tunnel charges were on two slides. So I know it's high on your priority, so could you just bring us up to date on that? And the other one was on capacity of your office.
Do you want to do the tunnels first? Okay, on the tunnels, the reason it's on twos because there's a consultation process, and through the transport committee here, through Mersey Travel, they'll be coming forward with options papers. So it's very much what I want to do and what I committed to do as the Metro Mayor. Whether it's doable under the financial envelope that we have, that's for others to decide. So they're going away and doing all of that piece of work. And anybody who's on that, on that one as well, on the transport committee, but they'll be part of bringing forward the recommendations. But at the end of the day, it's a decision for the provider authority. I very much want to steer towards seeing if we can reduce the burden for those people, because they, over the walls especially, you see it as a tax on their income. And I want to get as many people as we possibly can to use other methods of payment. So fast tag, what we're going to introduce, but we're having a look at introducing the AMPR, the stuff that we've got on the Mersey Gateway, which is the number plate recognition system. So there are technological advancements which might speed up transactions, but also try to avoid the need for cash payments. Cash payments are things that slow things down, if anybody knows, and be stuck behind somebody who uses coins, keep on coming out of work. So there's a whole host of options for us, but that would be between the democratic processes of this organisation to decide. On the gateway, you're right, it's £2, and there are a number of organisations, quite rightly, who are concerned that that is going to be an impediment to work and economic growth opportunities for people there. It's a government contract, it's a private sector operator, not part of the devolution deal. Absolutely, it's something that we need to be cognizant of. Yes, because of the knock-on effect of what might happen in the tunnel. So we are trying to formulate something that absolutely takes into full awareness and context everything that's happening on the complex. Internally, capacity, if we had the option of having more people on day one when we walked in, would I want it? Yeah, I'm certain it would. Andy Burnham from Manchester walked into a quite large organisation. But I think it would be interesting, perhaps one of the universities might do something on this, it would be interesting to see as an experiment which one gets the best results. Because whilst there was capacity in Greater Manchester, there was very little flexibility to develop things as you want to be in the person coming into the job for the first time. Whereas here, we have flexibility to develop the teams as we think it best suits the needs of what we've walked into. So we're in the process of finalising the structure. Everything, as you know, being a scrutiny committee, everything has to be signed off, so it goes through all the appropriate mechanisms, the chief executives. That will be done hopefully in the next few days, and then we'll be happy to share that with everybody. What I'm trying desperately to do is to get value for money, to have it as lean as we possibly can, to ensure that there aren't duplication of roads elsewhere. So we have, for instance, left staff who are working here. The 12 floors being cleared
and the leper now away from those sides. So that negates the need for us to do certain things, because the leper doing it with us and for us. We've got a skills team that came from Nosley, if anyone is an Nosley councillor. The skills team come from Nosley, but they're waving now again alongside the leper team. So we start to build genuine capacity, put people working together in a much more coordinated way than probably we would have done if we hadn't walked in and everything was all dead out for us. But I think that we'll be up to speed, and certainly the next couple of months, with increasing all the people to the posts that are being advertised. We have an interim head of paid service who's doing a fantastic job, obviously. And that permanent chief executive head of paid service is really important for our future. So we're looking at that as the next stage, and that be advertised. Go out to all the necessary organisations. We want the best quality people, the right skills to take the situation forward, and that's going to be a trial.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any more questions from the floor? Councillor Robertson Collins.
Thank you. Thanks for that, Steve. A lot of very concrete and proposals there, and a lot of very positive stuff. Just on a couple of the specifics on that. Page up on the screen there. Good to see the digital summit on there. I'm just wondering what emphasis that yourself, your general work, and maybe that summit will be looking at in terms of digital inclusion as a specific element of that. Obviously, we want to be a highly digital city in the sort of high-tech side of it, but we obviously do have in this city a big problem with digital exclusion, and that's actually already been touched on when we're talking about the cashless payments and the information on transport. So I'm just wondering kind of, you know, what we can do going forward through the combined authority in terms of inclusion there. And just another little specific question on the publication of the brownfield list, which does cause me to panic slightly, with the history of greenfield, green space issues in Liverpool City Council. I'm just wondering where that information comes from and where that's kind of clear first at local authority level before that goes public, because that is the sort of thing that we've had unfortunate experiences before in Liverpool City Council.
Okay, on the digital stuff, the reason that for me it's so important, and digital inclusion, but the digital strategy, is 12 months ago, I was made aware of something that had happened in Chattanooga, and I'm sure everybody remembers it, the song in Chattanooga, teaching. So have a look, and last week, through Mayor Bloomberg, and again, if anybody knows me, I don't fly, I've only flown to the European Confinement. But I don't fly, and we were invited to go to New York to meet Mayor Bloomberg, and there were 40 mayors, global mayors, and one of them was from Chattanooga. His name's Andy Burke, Mayor Andy Burke, and he turned the post-industrialized wasteland, it's called the dirtiest city in America, and he turned it into the gay city, and it's a feeder city for what's happening in Silicon Valley. And there was a fellow also from Liverpool. He went from Heaven Valley to Silicon Valley, but also dealing with it. But basically, he had a strategy to turn this wasteland into the best connected, quick speed, cheapest connectivity of any city in America. And he's reinvented it. You all go and have a Google on it, have a look what he's done. I wanted to find out how. That was really why I got on a plane and went to this event. But there's loads of other fantastic stuff. But smart cities are the way forward, and we need to better connect things that we already have. Without going into too much detail, we've got some huge natural assets that we have here, and some digital assets that are not fully interconnected. If we do that, we can reposition city region as a similar sort of city region as Chattanooga. I want to in the UK to become not just the UK's energy coast, but also to become a place for digital revolution, to take advantage of what's called the LCR 4.0 and the 4.0 industrial revolution. So that's why all that's in there, and it will include
is about if we do this, what are the benefits to residents as well as the residents? And everybody gets connected. And the way to do it, I mean, I went to that TUC thing that I think you and Mars upstairs and spoke to those people. And even if it's just engaging people, because older people might want to speak to their sons or daughters or grandchildren living in a different country through Skype or Office. If it's only that, and we can do it, and it's the highest speeds, you get people involved in the digital revolution when they don't even know that they're doing it. So that's the question. On the Brownfield Register, it's part of the devolution deal. It's something that we have to do. You can all get the devolution deal. It's on the Treasury website and download it. So it's a statutory duty for us, and there's the time scale for us as well, by which we have to. I know that any issues on brownfield, greenfield, development, economic regeneration, air quality, they're all going to be contentious issues. It's something that we have to deal with as a combined authority. It's not about cities anymore, or about the district. It is a city region strategy. Has been checked.
Yeah.
David came up with the constitution, so
so just to help councillor, that will be led by the mayor of advisors. The lead on that area is Mike Paley, who's chief executive at Elements, and he's currently liaising with the officers and members and individual authorities to bring together a city region approach that will come through the due process, but it will be. Its genesis will be built up from individual borough areas rather than a top-down imposition. It needs to be addressed, as the Mayor said, over a city-region footprint, but it will grow up rather than be imposed from down. That's the proposal, but that will be for the Mayor and the combined authority to consider, for you to scrutinise if you consider that appropriate, that there's a lot of process to go through. I'm sure it will be very challenging.
The scrutiny before I go to public vote concerns me, before you get everywhere.
Anything that comes here is public. So of course the combined authority is all over.
Okay, and I saw Councillor Leach.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for the presentation, Steve. Just a quick question for me regarding the Housing First report. You know, I think it's evident that we are seeing more and more homeless people on the streets, and a lot of those rough sleepers have fallen through the cracks in our rules and regulations. I just feel that now that we've got obviously welfare reform changes as well, that we're going to see an increase in terms of homelessness. And I just really wanted to ask your views on the Housing First report and what your intentions are as well.
Well, if anyone's read it, they'll note that absolutely government policy has a direct bearing on the number of people that we find either homeless or sleeping rough on the streets. But government's part of the solution. So this is a gift for us. The report was something like £1.5 million. It was funded through the European Union, through DCLG, and through Crisis. And it was launched actually in Finland, but because we were underpaid and then getting to Liverpool at a later date. And it's a whole system change that you need. It's not tinkering around the edges. Everybody's. I think there was some misunderstanding that Crisis or the report itself is in some way critiquing or being critical of stuff that's happening. It's absolutely not. It's quite the opposite. It's saying, despite what the problems are, sometimes because of government policy, the way in which you go forward is on a city region footprint. So we'd like to do it on a national footprint. Do we have to have a trailblazer somewhere? And they picked Liverpool City Region. It wasn't like we asked for it. Other areas would have picked their hands off to being the area chosen for this feasibility study. So have a look at what currently happens and all the good practice that happens in the city region, but where the gaps are, and it's more about where the gaps are. And so what they're saying is that for far too long we've worked in silos, and that compartmentalisation doesn't help the people who end up, unfortunately, in a situation where they find themselves at homes or sleeping rough on the streets. So it's called housing first, only because what you try to do is to tackle the housing issue first, get them with the roof over their heads, and then look at what the fundamental issues are and try and tackle that with wraparound services. So it's people like, you know, the health service, mental health service, it's councils, it's housing associations, it's everybody all coming together and putting aside, if you're like, I don't do that bit, putting it all aside to join together to tackle the issue. The ethos is that nobody should be homeless or sleeping on the streets. It's a huge ask, but it's actually worked in other areas. So it's a long way to go because this is not Liverpool City Regions. We don't own it. The governments have to buy into it because they're the ones who decide on how funding. But where our ask is, they were part of this region. They didn't want the tripartite people who commissioned it. They need to put some money now if they want to make this work, and we should be the first area in which we have a look at a whole system change to make housing first a reality in the city. The other thing is that they identified that 47% of homelessness is in the group, which is everybody knew, 25% of the group. And then 7, 7, 7, 7, they could do it, there was 7% each. So it affects everybody. But the big cities always attract more people. So if Liverpool, as they're doing some fantastic things, if they were to be demonstrably successful, what can happen is that it can attract more people over time. And that's why it needs to be a Liverpool city region footprint. If anybody's seen what's happened in Manchester, they tried to tackle it in a different way, and their homelessness and what's looking back is growing to attract people from within 9 years of the development into the city of Manchester. That's why we need a big footprint to make us.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Brennan. Okay, if it's quick, I'm conscious that the mayor has to be out of here by 12, and I want to give everybody the opportunity. So if it's quick, Councillor Leach, go on quickly, and then Councillor Brennan.
It is quite
quick.
Okay, thank you. Just in terms of that, Stephen, thank you for your comments. Do you feel there needs to be some government reform in because of, we have situations, obviously, where people who are homeless, if they try to get in with a private landlord, they can't always get a guarantor, and it leaves them back on the streets.
And that's what the report identifies. It's not. It does some look at what's going wrong, type stuff, but also what can we do to put that right. And that's why it's absolutely essential that we look into why it's in, because they can affect the change that we think everybody all has to see.
Thank you, Councillor Brennan.
Well, Steve, thanks very much for your presentation. My question is about really our role and how it enhances the work that's going on, particularly in the mayor's office, in developing those links. Clearly, you see scrutiny is going to be around challenge and support, also examining and reviewing. We've got a key role and how we can actually develop that. So, having said that, there's a lot of stuff currently happening over the last 12 months and important decisions to be made.